Everybody, well, I will introduce myself first. My name is Megan Lane. I am the community director here at RISC-V International. I've been here for 4 years. I love my job. I love what I do. I get to support students and the community and universities. I do things such as help create the fundamentals course, the certification, all the free courses that you see. I also do a lot of the community initiatives. So I run these coffee chats, which is essentially an opportunity for the community to hear from RISC-V International about programs that we run. I work with the ambassadors and the advocates. I help run events like our career fairs and our mentorship program and our hackathon that we're hosting for the first time in Europe. If you are in Europe or can make it to Munich, I recommend that you check out RISC-V Summit Europe. It is not next week, but the week after, starting on Monday. And so that's really exciting for us to do that. So I will go ahead and just dive in. One of the things that we are going to do is show you essentially how to find all the things on our website. We understand there are a lot of things on our website for you to learn. So we want to make sure that you are fully aware of how you can utilize the resources that we provide here at RISC-V International to have your best experience. Because what we understand is the only way for RISC-V to grow is for our contributors to understand, learn, and continue to build on what RISC-V is already. So I will go ahead and start. And this makes me realize I need to change how I, share a different screen. I'm just gonna share my entire screen. Sorry, you're gonna see yourselves here for a minute. Oh, I'm sharing my Slack, aren't I? You can see my music choice. On window, entire screen, here we go. Apologies for that, it's gonna be a little scary for a minute. So the first thing I wanna go over is how to join as a member. So to join RISC-V International as an individual, there is no cost. To join RISC-V International as a university, there is no cost. So by joining as a member, it's the only way that you are able to go into our event or our meetings, our working groups, our SIGs, anything like that. To really be an active participant of RISC-V, you need to join as a member. Now, we do encourage you to join as an organization, but if you are an individual, which I think a number of the people joining this are, you would just join here. You essentially go through and have a contract and just sign it. You can read it. It's a fair number of pages. We're not taking anything from you, but just so you know, that's what it is. So that's the first thing that you should really do to become an active participant of RISC-V International. Then we just created this. So this is student SIG mailing list. So essentially once you become a member, you'll be added to the all mem emails, which we don't send many emails in there, but that's the main group. So once you become a member, then you can get access to groups.io, which is where we hold all of our mailing lists. So Raphael will go over more of the technical ones in a moment. But if you join this, we want this to be the place that you go and see and ask questions, right? If you're new to RISC-V, you're starting on something, you can go there and ask questions, right? And we're going to have the advocates in there responding to questions. Our team is in there to respond to questions for you. So it's a great opportunity for you to just sort of get started. The next thing I'll talk about is the, just learning about RISC-V, right? You can read basic things on our website in the about section. There's a lot of great older videos here that I think is a good opportunity for you to review. You can also see all of these. You can find all of our YouTube channel that shows, you can watch every conference video we've had. Right. So if it's at a RISC-V summit, you can watch all the videos here. That's a great opportunity for you. So just like learning about RISC-V in general, you can subscribe to our newsletter. We have three different types of newsletter. The technical newsletter is done by Raphael, and I'll let him explain in a minute what you can find in those. The educational newsletter is done by Camille and myself. This is the first place that we announce things like scholarships, mentorships launching. You know, we just did a birthday giveaway. So it was like 14 people randomly were selected to receive the fundamentals and the RVFA certification for free. So this is the place that we announce that. We send one email a month. It's at the beginning of the month. It's very short and sweet. The marketing email has more, I believe, general RISC-V information. Again, I don't think any of these send more than one. Do you send more than one email a month, Raphael? Maybe just announce it. Yeah. So they're very, you're not going to get a lot of emails from those, but I recommend you sign up to those to know what's happening. The next thing is our Slack. So our Slack channels are here. You can get the link right here to join our Slack, and then you can join all of the different subgroups. So good ones to know are the new to RISC-V. I usually post new things that I'm launching in there. RISC-V for All was for questions about our scholarships. If you're applying for a mentorship, this is where you go to ask questions. This is a more active group. Let's see, what else? The general is one of the most active ones. So yeah, just getting to know the Slack and having that as well as the new to RISC-V subgroup, I think are great places for you to learn more about or ask questions in general. So now I'm gonna show you the available resources. We have a lot of different areas that you can find educational materials. This is built by the community. It's actually built by one of our mentees. And so it's got a great outline for basically beginner and intermediate level resources for you to have hands-on learn or for you to learn. There are some hands-on learning in there. There is a lot of direction to other resources that we have. So I really recommend that you take some time and go through this page specifically because it's got a lot of resources. So do that, and then I will hand it over to Raphael to go through the technical wiki and active working groups.
Sure. So just one step back. If you go to that main list that we just created, so that's we noticed that when someone is willing to help RISC-V and they do not know how to get started, they even have some hard time finding a place to ask a question, how can I help? So, or how can, what is going on to me? And then we decided that maybe we should put in place a easy way to ensure people feel safe and ensure they can ask questions, any kind of questions, and we can support them. So if you are new to RISC-V and you need to understand what a task group is, you can ask what a task group is. If you need to understand how to build it or how to create a specification, you can ask that question and we're going to answer and give you some pointers. If you are willing to understand what are the set of compilers support RISC-V, just ask the question. So we intend to help to create the environment where the community can help everyone. So it's built by the community and driven by the community, and we're going to support that. So everyone is going to help each other there to ensure everyone can succeed. As part of the learning, just a quick comment, the learning repository, that's also something that we need to build together. So if you have anything to add, just raise a pull request. Let's say there's a new learning tutorial in Spanish or in whatever language that's worth adding. So just open a pull request. So we're going to accommodate that in the table. That's a place or that's a location where we are willing to share what is really good, what the resources are really, the interesting resources are available there so we can share with everyone. As you saw, we have a good number of people watching that repository. So every time we do some change there, a lot of individuals are going to get notified. So feel free to contribute. Moving on to the technical side about what we have. So we have today around 52 specifications on the fly. Some are going to get ratified this year, another, I mean, not this year, but throughout the next couple of years. But we have a lot of movement going on. So to understand how you can, or to understand what's going on, the key point or the key entry point is the technical wiki. So you can type wiki.riscv.org or tech.riscv.org, and you're going to land in this page. And from here, you can go to basically, I mean, any place that gives you the necessary understanding about what's going on the specification side. So if you need to understand about what is going on, so you can click on active specification status. That's going to give you a consolidated view with all the specifications we have on the fly right now. Sorry. If you want to understand what are the test groups and who are leading them, you can go back there and click on active groups. And then you're going to see every single test group, SIGs and HCs, that are active and producing RISC-V resources or outcomes somehow. And you can see who is leading the company, the individual, even you have the mail list. So if you're willing to start joining the conversation, you can, and if you are a member, of course, you can click in the mail list link and join that mail list. We have more resources there, like Megan, if you go back to the wiki, like you can see our technical newsletter resources. So we released the newsletter based on the good amount of resources we have. If we have good amount of news, we're going to release that. Otherwise, we're going to postpone so we can accumulate more information. But anyway, this is the entry point from the technical side. If you want to start exploring, see the links we have here. We have the links for the GitHub, so you can explore everything that is, let's say, under development today. And also, if we need help, there's a nice email there from the technical side. So if you need help from the technical side, just ask for help. So this is the key page to bookmark. So if you want to help start exploring the technical side and how to get involved somehow, the information should be here. And if you do not find information or if you need more details, we have now that nice mailing list where you can ask for help. So let's say you are willing to embrace RISC-V, but you cannot, but you believe you cannot develop a new specification, but you have a nice CI/CD knowledge, for instance, and you can build CI. So one good way to help RISC-V from the technical side is to enable an open source project, for instance, to run on RISC-V and enable a CI. It can be today using cross compilation or even enabling in a small developer board to start to build a RISC-V. That's going to be really helpful for the community from the ecosystem point of view. So that's one simple way to help. You can help us on the technical side also review the documentation. If you're not feel comfortable looking at the technical side, technical details, you can just help us with the more about the language. Maybe there are some typos here and there that should be fixed. So we have added in the main ISA repository the good first issue tag. So there is an opportunity to start engaging like that. So we have few for now, but we're going to add more. So that's a, let's say, low-hanging fruit kind of solution that we can help you, or problem that you can help us to solve. So we started that recently. We have the documentation team helping us to tag some issues here, but we're going to add more so you can help and feel comfortable helping us there. What else we can tell about the technical side? Megan, if you go to your slide, I think that can give me some pointers about what we also need to tell. Okay, so yeah, we talk about technical week. We talk about active groups, which is important. We talk about Learn, where we have some free resources there. But I believe, yeah, so that's the entry point. But if you really want to start developing spec, of course, you need to understand the base of RISC-V, and that's where the certifications and the training kind of courses we have can help you. I believe Megan can talk more about that now.
Yeah, thanks, Rafael. So I think, really, we want you to start learning about RISC-V in the general. And then once you understand, you get a grasp of that, then it's great for you to dive into our courses. So we have a lot of free courses. This, you know, you can always start with the introduction to RISC-V. If you took this course, I think it was just re-updated within the last 6 months. If you've taken it before, I recommend you take it again because it really is upgraded, has a lot more technical nature, whereas before it was probably more just about RISC-V International as opposed to RISC-V. So there's a lot of free courses you can take here. I really recommend all of those. The fundamentals course is something that was created with the community. We created the RVFA certification in order for two things, right? It's for students that are graduating with a degree in computer sciences or computer engineering, an undergraduate degree, to really be able to partner that with what it is that they learned in school, right? To be able to show that they have the skill set and understand RISC-V to enter a career. Because what we're hearing from a lot of our members is that if you have the basic RISC-V understanding, they can teach you everything else you need to know in order to work in their company. So that's the biggest thing we're hearing. So that's why we created the RVFA course, because you're able to really prove that you have that basic level knowledge. This was made by people that are on the board, people that have been in the community for a long, long time. It is a difficult court test. It is a 90-minute proctor exam. I believe there's 60 questions that you're asked. You get two tries, right? And so what I often say is think of the first try as your understanding of how it works, because you do have to be in a clean room and things like that, because you are with a live proctor. So just understand that about the RVFA certification. It is something that lets our members know this person is knowledgeable in RISC-V. And in order to prepare for that, you can take the RISC-V fundamentals course. I know some people in here are already taking that. We have some of our member organizations buy this course in bulk for their members or for their employees. So it's something that people are seeing as really understanding the fundamentals of RISC-V. So I will give a coupon here. I'll just do it now. So if you buy the bundle, you get 30% off. Oh, I need someone I wanted to. You just click buy bundle. It'll give you that. So I'll give you that link and then I'll give you that code. This code is good until Camille. Do you remember when I made it? I think it was Friday. So the discount code, there you go, is the discount code. So those are two good places to start for education. And then I'll go over mentorships really quickly, and then I'll let Raphael go into the working group meeting. So if you haven't heard of our mentorship program before, these are paid opportunities. It is very competitive, so just know that in advance. You can watch sort of this past mentee showcase where they talk about the projects that they worked on. I'm getting awesome feedback from this program. People are telling me it helped them to really get engaged in the community, to meet people that mentored them in working in a group. It's just a lot of people are going on to get jobs. It's really cool. They're letting me know, you know, their progress. So it's a program I really love. So the fall semester is next. Summer session has just started. But essentially, you can apply to the mentorships starting July 15th. And if you want to be notified of that, join the newsletter for education, and we notify those people first and let them know that the applications have opened. You do have to do a coding challenge, but I highly recommend it. We do actually, because the program has gotten so popular, we are now offering multiple mentorships on the same project. Only the first selected person is paid. But it is a great opportunity for even those that are not getting paid to get that hands-on learning experience. So I really recommend that you check those out. And we are hoping to expand that program. I believe this year so far we've had 15 mentees. So it's a great resource. And then I will go back to you, Raphael, to talk about joining meetings. Working groups.
Yeah. So assuming you're joining RISC-V as a member, and you start, and if you, and you believe you can start contributing to the task groups, we have a public calendar. So the calendar is public, so anyone can see that, that we have the meetings. So we have a lot of meetings, by the way. And those meetings are targeting the members only. So if you're not a member and enjoy the meeting, maybe the host will ask you to leave if you're not a member. So in those meetings, they are kind of working meetings. So the TG, they're going to resume some work from the previous meeting, discuss a new talk, discuss some issues, but their end goal is to converge and create the specification data work. So every task group is working to deliver a specification as the result of their effort throughout a period of time. That can be 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, depending on the how complex the specification is. But yeah, we have, as you can see, we have a lot of meetings that are all activities meeting that we, it happens, if you will, you can spend your whole week just in meetings. It's really a lot. So again, if you are a member and you believe you are ready to start contributing, feel free to join the meeting because they need help. They need help developing the spec. They need help reviewing the spec. They, as Carl pointed out, they need help with upstream contributions. Like every spec throughout their life cycle, development life cycle, requires upstream contribution to GCC, LLVM, system libraries like libc, whatever, Linux kernel. So there's a bunch of work that's not really tied to the specification development itself, but with the ecosystem around that specification. So if you feel you can help on that front and you are willing to contribute, become a member, join the task group, and start helping them to push the specification forward. That's more than needed right now. Megan, believe that on the test.
Yeah, we went over our first good issue already. Again, those are just sort of starter things that you can do to find your way around. We will continue to add to those, especially if people are showing interest in doing things like that. That's something we want to do. Keith and I, so Keith is the chair of the Academic and Training Special Interest Group. So we work together a lot. We ran a video contest. We're running a hackathon that's coming up in person at RISC-V Summit Europe. We're very likely doing a RISC-V Summit North America hackathon. And something that we are working on right now is hosting monthly student learning opportunities where essentially it's not fully sorted out, but you'll come into the room, you'll get a problem, and then you'll have a month to work on. Right? We want you to have hands-on learning experiences where you're given access to simulators and emulators that you maybe wouldn't have known about previously. We're going to have professors and people that have made this type of content come in and, you know, teach you briefly how to use it, where to find resources, and then we'll create Slack or Discord channels for people to interact around that. So those are coming. Again, we will announce, I'm sorry to keep plugging my newsletter, but we will announce those first in that newsletter. If you're interested in education in any way, that is the place that we announce it. So just for you to know, these student learning groups are coming likely end of US summer, half of the world summer. So just know about that. Organizing a local event. So this is what Carl and the advocates do and the ambassadors do. This is our community events page. So what I recommend you do is you can join all the chapters. To be honest, most of the events are virtual, but this is a great opportunity for you to learn about events that are happening online or virtually. Carl does a great job with his events. This Austin one is in person, I believe. But just great opportunities for you to learn about events that are happening. I know the Bay Area group just launched a virtual event that's coming up, I believe, next week. Open Hours runs twice a month, and they talk about what's happening in a lot of those working groups. So it's a good place to go and listen and ask questions. So you can join based on your location. And once you join a group, anytime an event is added, you'll be sent an email. which just makes it really easy for you. So I recommend you do that. You can also host these events if you want to bring your local community together, or if you have speakers that you want to work with and feature. You can send me an email. It's just my first name, Megan@riskv.org, and I can help you get set up to become a host and host those types of events. So that's also one of the requirements to become an advocate. So if you're interested in that, I really recommend that you attend some of those events, learn how they run, and go from there. So the last thing that I will talk about is attending RISC-V Summit. If you are not aware, I want you to be aware that we do travel scholarships. The travel scholarship pays for your flight, your hotel, and your conference ticket. So these scholarships go to people who are active contributors, right? They don't just go to, they usually wouldn't go to a student who's brand new to RISC-V. It's someone who is actually already contributing in the community. And this is why we want to host programs like this, because we want you to start being active in the community so you can then come in person for free and network and meet the people that you're working with in the task groups and, you know, really make change. So something for you to consider. Those are the scholarships that we run. Just attending the events in general is such a great networking opportunity. We have RISC-V Summit Europe that is, I don't know which one of these tabs it is. Camille, can you grab the RISC-V Summit Europe? I don't know if any of these are them. Link can just shoot it out to everybody, or I can grab it in a minute. But so attending the events is a great opportunity to network. And then I will give it back to Raphael about proposing a new spec.
Yeah, so proposing a new spec is something hard, right? Because you need to understand the necessity. You need to understand the gap that you are wanting to propose a solution to help. But once you have done that and you understand there is something that you need to develop, and that can be an ISA, something that's part of the ISA, or can be something that's part is non-ISA. So once you have defined that you are a member, you define it, you decide that you need to propose something, there is a process that you need to follow. That process is not simple. I mean, overall it is simple, but we have a lot of steps throughout the development process. So you need to go to initial, first, you need to ensure that you have some kind of sponsorship from any of the governing committees with RISC-V. Once you have that and you are good to go, you need to build a plan an initial plan. And then also you need, depending on the situation, you need to build a task group. But we also have the possibility to run a specification or develop a specification as a fast track if that's a really small specification. But then once you have decided that you need a spec, you got the sponsorship, and you have decided whether or not either a fast track or a TG-driven specification, then you need to start following the same workflow for both scenarios, which is developing specification, go to the freeze phase, and go to ratification ready. So with me, so during the development, we expect you to do the specification development. So basically, RISC-V extension is a set of text that is put together to explain a scenario where that specification is solving a problem that we need as part of the ISA or non-ISA extension. Once you have done the document that, which is mean the text part of the spec, you go to the freeze phase. But the intersections, there is a lot of intersections between the phases, which means that you can develop a specification and during the development start also doing some upstream contributions. Later, once you get the specification in good shape, you go to the freeze phase where we expect there is a little kind of change, not a good amount of change in the specification, but you can still continue doing the process of integrating the specification as part of simulators, complete any upstream work, And all, as part of the freeze phase, we have a lot of, you have at least two approvals that goes to the process. The main approval is from the architectural review committee. Then you go to the freeze phase. As part of the freeze phase, we have the public review and more approval. So we have everything detailed, well detailed in the specification development guideline. But anyway, once you start doing the process, we're going to guide you and we're going to help you so you understand where you are and what you need to deliver. It's a simple process, but it requires a lot of work. And we are here to help you get that done.
Exactly. Thanks, Rafael. So I'll open it up now for questions. I saw a few questions in the chat. One of the other things I didn't mention is we are looking at doing global hackathons online. Our hope is that we can get groups together in different regions of the world. So it would be awesome if you're at a university and you're interested in having, you know, more of an in-person hackathon at your university. Essentially, we will run, I think, a 24-hour hackathon is what we're looking at, but you do it in your local region, right, with your community. So global hackathons are coming. Again, it's all based on simulators and emulators. If in case people need hardware, we know it's hard to get hardware these days. I think that was the main question I saw. But yeah, I'll go ahead and let other people ask questions. I saw one question, how do you join a test group? Rafael.
The key or the easy path is go to the tech.riskv.org, and there you have the list of active groups. Search for the name of the group or the keyword like debug or test and check their main list that is available there, is listed in that table. So click on the link and you can join the main list. If you are willing to join the meeting, go to the same location the week and search for the calendar and then look for the meeting for the test group. And then you can start helping or joining those meetings to contribute. Mm-hmm. But my initial suggestion would be try joining the mailing list first and see what they are discussing.
Yeah, I think even just joining and listening in and seeing where things are at, right? And then asking if there's things you can do to be helpful. I think that those go a long way. So I think that's a good way to start. What about building CPUs?
Yeah, we do not do that, right? RISC-V International is responsible for maintaining the ISA. We do not do the development. We do not have a platform. Like, we do not offer implementation. That's the key part. We just handle the ISA and maintain the ISA to ensure it continue to be open, continue to be free, and anyone can help build that. So then if you maybe building CPUs is something that our members are doing right now. So maybe you can reach out some of them. We have the list of members in our website that can help you if you need to be.
And I think building those relationships in person at the events is also a great way to do it. It's a more technical one, Rafael.
Yeah, so that's a good question. Right now, as part of RISC-V, we have two key task groups that are creating the resources you're going to need for machine learning. We have one work on integrated matrix extension and another work on a touched matrix extension. They are both task groups are working to define the best matrix instructions that can be used to implement accelerators. Can be a custom accelerator or a more general proposal accelerator. So right now, if you are willing to see where things are going, I would highly recommend you to become a member if you're not and join both task groups meetings, because there in that meeting you're going to see individuals from IBM, from NVIDIA, from a lot of members company discussing what are the best matrix instructions. And they are thinking, or they are doing that to consider the inferencing process and for all the training and everything that should be needed for AI, and also for deploying that later in the process. So if you want to understand more about that, I will highly recommend you join those. And of course, the individuals doing that are the best individuals in the world. And I'm pretty sure you'll be really happy to join and see what they are planning and what they are doing. Because, I mean, I know some of those guys personally, and they have done that for other companies in the past. And they are not really just doing some matrix extension. They are doing the best matrix extension.
Thanks, Rafael. Any other questions? I know we've gone over. It's never a bad thing. No. Now is your chance to ask us live. All right. Well, you know how to reach out to us. You can join the once you've joined as a member, you can then send us messages within the new group. And I think that that's a great way for you to get started, right? Join the Slack, ask questions, meet people in the community. I mean, the one thing that we are finding is there are so many open jobs. We need people trained in RISC-V to, you know, have progress in the future. So if you are looking for a job, please, please join us. Please start contributing. Please start your process now, so that when you are graduating or when you're ready for your next career move, that you've already got the skill set and the knowledge to go into our member organizations and, you know, putting in the work to help us grow, because we know we're the next big thing, right? So please participate. Please reach out if you have any questions. No worries, John. I will email out the recording to everyone. You'll also be able to find the recording once it processes just on the original event page. We're so happy you're all here. Because you joined this event, anytime we host a future coffee chat, you will be notified. They are usually about a half an hour, and we just really look forward to seeing you and your active participation in the community. So don't be shy in reaching out. Thanks so much for joining. We'll see you all again soon. Take care.